When I cover a song, the reason why I do it is generally because I want to learn something from it. So the reason why I covered Hell March was because I wanted to practice the fine art of heavy metal chugging. Chugs are those real low, heavily distorted, percussive notes that give metalheads excessive amounts of joy. For a metalhead, they're super exciting, they've got all the impact, all the drive, all the explosive energy, and they're probably the most important part of most heavy metal riffs. In my very humble opinion, thrash metal is the home of the best chugs you will ever hear in metal, with James Hetfield and Gary Holt taking the crown for the greatest chuggy guitar players I've ever heard. That being said, chugging has become such like an iconic thing that an entire subgenre surrounding chugs has come out of the metal community, and that subgenre is called djent. So let's explore chugging and let's work out how we can get the best from it. In order to play in a chuggy sort of way, you need to learn how to palm mute. Palm muting is very easy. All you need to do is rest the fleshy part of your hand here on the bridge of your guitar as you play. What effect this has is that it sort of chokes off the note a little bit and sort of keeps things punchy, but it's not a complete mute, so note still actually comes through rather than just being a click. Muting the string entirely sounds like this. Palm muting sounds like this. Now, if you don't palm mute the string, basically the note just rings out with zero percussive attack, and it's all energy but no punch. Basically, what you end up with is a real late 90s pop punk chorus sort of effect, which is cool, there's nothing wrong with that, but it's not gonna get you the chugs. I'd like to be more specific about exactly where to put your hand and how much pressure to apply, but honestly, it's going to depend on your guitar and what sort of bridge setup you have. However, generally speaking, the most exciting riffs to listen to are a combination of really choked off chuggy notes combined with really wide open notes in between. You get a whole bunch of different energy flying around in the riffs. You get a lot of energy and excitement from it because there's a lot of things going on. So it's important to practice clamping down on a chug really quickly, as well as coming off for like a single accented note as well. The last piece of the puzzle is that you need to dig in with your pick. You have to attack the strings. And this is where Hetfield is legendary. He's attacking those strings like they owe him money. I wouldn't be shocked if they have to change his strings at the end of every show because he's savage, and that's what makes Hetfield sound so amazing. Even when you're doing really fast, gallopy, triplety sort of stuff, you need to be digging in. This is where a lot of metal players prefer to play with a really thick pick that gives them a lot of attack, rather than, you know, like a 60mm nylon sort of thing that sort of flops around everywhere. Try not to dig in so much that you push your notes sharp. This is something that can really happen when you're down-tuned a long way, but you're not trying to make your guitar gently weep here, you're trying to make your guitar shout like a stuck pig. So in terms of playing, there's three different things you're looking for. You need to make sure that you're palm muting, you need to make sure that your hand is in the right spot on the bridge and that you're applying enough pressure, and finally, you need to be attacking the string properly. So that's basically the technique summed up, but what about gear? Generally speaking, in order to get good, heavy, awesome chugs, you need to be playing gear that's designed to do it. Most of the time, the best sounding chugs that have ever been recorded have come from a proper, full tube, high gain amplifier designed to chug. That being said, that doesn't mean you just set everything to 10 and go nuts. I've seen a lot of common mistakes with guitar players over the years, so here's how I like to set things up. So when planning this video, my intention was to like have an amp right next to me and, well, okay, yeah, like that, and drape my arm over it and pretend like it's my best mate and go through all the controls and stuff like that and really show you how I like to dial in an amp. But then I had a look at what amps I have in here, and as it turns out, pretty much all of my amps have some sort of a weird EQ where if I showed you the settings I'm using on those amps, it's not really going to reflect the ideas that I'm talking about, especially looking at the Mesa Mark V. So, showing you the settings I use on my amps, I don't think would be a really good demonstration because they're all set up in a completely different way. It's not some massive trade secret. If you want me to post my settings, I'm happy to do that. But rather than give you settings and be like, oh yeah, these are the settings you're after, I'm going to tell you my philosophy and my approach to dialing in an amp, and hopefully then with your ears and my ideas, you can create something awesome. Basically what I'm saying is going online and looking up a bunch of settings on how to dial in an amp, it's probably not the approach that's going to lead you to the best results. So, in terms of bass, middle, treble, which controls pretty much every guitar amplifier is going to have, the mid-range is the most important one and where you start off. The guitar is a mid-range instrument. That means the voice of your instrument is somewhere in that mid-range. This means that you want as much of your voice to come through as possible, so you want as much mid-range as humanly possible. This doesn't just apply to chugs, this applies to guitar tone in general. So the first thing I do whenever I start dialing in an amp is I crank the mids as high as humanly possible until things start to get really pointy or a little bit too fluffy. It kind of depends on how that amp reacts to the mids. Once I've got a little bit too much mids, then what I do, I try to compensate with the other controls. So if it's a little bit too pointy, I roll off the treble and see if that sort of smooth things out. Effectively, I actually try to get the brightness in my guitar tone from the mid-range rather than from the treble or the presence controls. Likewise, if it's sounding a bit too fluffy, try rolling off the bass and sort of seeing if that brings the punch back into it. Now, a common mistake people make when dialing in an amp is that they completely gut the mid-range. They scoop all the mids out of their tone so that all that's coming out of the speakers is bass and treble. Now, in a room by yourself, it's really gargantuan amounts of fun because all that bottom end is making things feel huge and percussive and everything like that. Then you've got the really bright and clear top end from the treble, so it sounds like you've got tons of attack, you've got tons of attack, you've got tons of punch. It's like, yes, this sounds amazing. But it completely disappears in a mix. Or as somebody else has said before,
you won't sound big, you won't sound heavy, you will just not be heard.
As a case in point, here's what How Much sounded like with mids. Now here's what it sounds like with the mid-range scooped out of it. Can you hear how little guitar there is once you've scooped the mids? The guitar by itself sounds great because it's all attack and body, but when dropped into a mix, the bass guitar and kick drum are taking up all that body, and the cymbals and everything else are taking up all the attack. So the space that's been left for your guitar, the mid-range, there's nothing there. So the whole thing just kind of sounds a little bit weak and a little bit lame. Speaking of bass, this is another very common mistake I see people make, especially people looking for some pretty brutal chugs. Now, the thing that gives the illusion of punch for all of your notes, it isn't like this huge amount of bass that sits underneath your note the entire time. It's actually this bass that appears and disappears, because then it is literally like a punch. You've got some sort of a bass transient there pushing things forward. If you've dialed up the bass so that it's sort of like you've got this constant fluffy drone under everything, you're not getting that illusion of that punch. Also, the bass in the mix should come from the bass guitar. That's why he's there. Let that guy deal with the bottom end thump and you deal with all the beautiful mid-range voicing stuff. Your guitar should blend in with his bass and not fight it. So if you've cranked the bass on your amp, you are just stepping all over his toes, he's stepping all over your toes, and you've just sort of created mud instead of punchy definition. So in terms of dialing in an amp, get as much mid-range as you can, Use mid-range for brightness rather than treble and sort of balance the mid-range and treble out. And finally, use as little bass as you can. Get the bass to appear, but make sure it's the first thing that disappears from your note in order to give enough room for your bass guitar to have some fun. The last thing we need to talk about in terms of dialing in an amp is gain. How much do we need? So for Chugs, we need a lot. I mean, there's no getting around it. We need a lot of gain if we're trying to do Chugs. That Fender Bassman over there, it's not gonna chug. Not without some serious effort put into it. So we've got a high gain amplifier, let's use a fair bit of gain. But there's a few things you need to know about gain in a guitar amplifier. When you add gain, it doesn't just add like distortion and overdrive, it adds a huge amount of frequencies to pretty much the entire spectrum of frequencies, but especially the mid-range. So when you've got the gain cranked, the bass is gonna flub out, the mid-range is gonna get real pointy, and that top end is gonna turn into like this massive fizzy mess. So my approach to gain is kinda like my approach to bass. You get away with as little as you possibly can, and that includes when you're using a high gain amplifier. As a side note, this is why it looks like on a lot of high gain amplifiers that players have scooped the hell out of their mids. Often, if you listen to the guitar tone, there's plenty of mid-range in there, but when you've got high gain going through a guitar amplifier, you're also going to have a lot of mids. So that's why, in terms of amp settings, you often see a scooped mid, but if you listen with your ears, you'll realize, no, there's still plenty of mid-range there. Great example of that is the Mesa Mark V. The famous VEQ looks like you're absolutely gutting the mid-range. You're actually not. It's just that that amp has a gargantuan amount of mid-range. So in order to make it sound awesome, you gut the mids. So when you're dialing in the gain on a high gain amplifier, aim to get away with as little gain as possible. That will keep your bass tight, that'll keep your mid-range, you know, nice and pronounced without getting pointy or flubby, and it'll stop the top end from sounding like a fizzy, indistinct mess. The other thing you need to consider as well is that generally when we play metal, there's going to be two guitars playing the same thing, especially when recorded when we're double tracking. If both guitars have as much gain as humanly possible, they're taking up all the room in the mix. They're going to be taking up all the bottom end, all the top end and everything like that, and they're going to be stepping on absolutely every instrument in the mix, plus they're going to be stepping on each other, and you're just going to end up with this great big fuzzy wall of what are they actually playing? Mind you, I know Doom guys are after that, so hey, if that's what you're going for, carry on, enjoy your muff pedals. There's one more trick to consider when we're talking about gain in an amplifier, especially in a high gain context, and that is adding an overdrive pedal. The way we usually set up a overdrive pedal in a metal setting is that we run the drive at zero, the volume at maximum, and the tone or the EQ to taste, depending on your amp and what it needs. The effect that this has is that the front end of your amplifier gets hit a little bit harder by the boosted signal by the overdrive pedal. So that means your pick attack has more gain and a little bit more aggression and a little bit more punch to it, but the note overall doesn't. It kind of just seems to affect the transients. The end result is that things kind of go chug, 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 rather than going dun, dun, dun. It's basically the standard trick done by most metal bands these days, and generally speaking, the pedal that they use is a Tube Screamer of some sort. Now, while the fabled Tube Screamer is an excellent place to start for this, I don't think it is the be-all and end-all of metal boosts. I used to when I was running a Mesa rectifier, but since my palate has expanded, I've discovered that the Tube Screamer isn't necessarily it. A Tube Screamer will add mids, which is really, really good, especially when you've had to scoop the mids a little bit in order to compensate for the gain or whatever. But the problem is that if your amp already is throwing out a bunch of mids, for example, a Marshall, adding a tube screamer on top of that doesn't really help things. You're kind of adding mids on top of mids. I recommend starting off with a tube screamer, but if the tube screamer isn't working for you, experiment with other overdrive pedals. See what you come up with. But really quickly, here's a demonstration from the pedal gauntlet where I run a Mesa rectifier and a tube screamer, which is like the most classic combination you can get. Black and white means that the tube screamer is off. Color means that the tube screamer is on, and I hope you can hear the differences. When the tube screamer was on, it rolled off a bunch of bass, which tightened things up a little bit. It added mid-range to that Mesa rectifier, which sort of pushed things forward a little bit and sort of filled some gaps that the Mesa rectifier has. And it added some aggression to the pick attack, but it didn't really add that much more gain. So even if your amp has as much gain as you could possibly want, try setting the gain about halfway and boosting it with an overdrive pedal. You'll probably end up with punchier, cleaner results that have way more impact on the audience. I've also seen people sometimes talk about using a compressor pedal for chugs. I don't like this approach in the slightest. The problem with the compressor pedal is that it generally chops off the transients or your pick attack. And the pick attack is where the ch in the chug is. It just sort of flattens everything out and you don't really get that bouncy sort of feel. So not a massive fan of compressors for adding chugs or, you know, boosting the front end of an amp. Would always much rather use an overdrive pedal, or do consider some clean boost pedals. The Gary Holt signature pedal is a mid boost pedal, and my god, that thing is amazing, especially into my Marshall. So do look at like a clean boost more so than a compressor. So those things should get you well on your way to chugging. By using the right technique of palm muting and choking off the notes and sort of bouncing between palm muting and not, you'll be playing the right way. And by dialing in your amp with huge amounts of mid-range, not much bass, balanced amount of treble, and a good amount of gain without getting into the fizzy or flubby territory, you should be approaching some nice, chunky, ugly face-inducing heavy chugs that sit really well in a mix and have a ton of impact for your audience. As with all things audio and gear, however, please remember to use your ears first and foremost. Make sure things sound good to you. Don't look up settings, because if they're using different gear to you, they might need those settings and you might need something completely different. Play with these ideas, play with adding as much mid-range as you can get away with, and hopefully we all end up with something that sounds awesome. Just don't scoop the mids. Unless you're James Hetfield. Hetfield gets away with it, but Hetfield is God. What?